Good morning. Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. I invite you to worship today. Come, all of you who feel lost, alienated, alone. At one time, we felt that way. We didn't belong anywhere. We just wanted somewhere to be. Christ, the strong cornerstone of our house, welcomes you. Once we were no people, now we are God's people. Once we had no place to dwell, now we live and abide in God's love. Thanks be to God for God's gracious love and hospitality. Amen.
Thank you.
Before turning to scripture, let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Our scripture lesson today comes from Psalm 31, verses 1 through 5, and then skipping forward to 15 through 16. Listen now for these words of the Psalter. In you, O Lord, I seek refuge. Do not let me ever be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me. Incline your ear to me. Rescue me speedily. Be a rock of refuge for me, a strong fortress to save me. You are indeed my rock and my fortress. For your name's sake, lead me and guide me. Take me out of the net that is hidden for me, for you are my refuge. Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God. Skipping forward to verse 15. My times are in your hand. Deliver me from the hand of my enemies and persecutors. Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me in your steadfast love. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Before we begin, I want to just let you all know that right now, Governor Kelly has said we will open up to 30 or more with phase two beginning the 18th of May. Your session is planning to meet sometime around that time to begin to talk about procedures. I will be meeting with our executive presbyter, Melanie Hancock, along with other pastors, Presbyterian pastors in Shawnee County, to just make sure that we know for sure what we need to do to be following guidelines. We will be doing that over a Zoom meeting sometime again soon. So we have this Sunday, and we'll have next Sunday for sure here online, and we will let you know as soon as we know when it is safe to begin worshiping together and meeting together. So those things stay close in our hearts. So thoughts and prayers. Some people find them valuable, while others would actually pay to avoid them. A recent study found that Christians generally value the offer of thoughts and prayers even from a stranger. Two sociologists studied a group of North Carolina residents in the fall of 2018 after Hurricane Florence struck. They talked with more than 400 residents, asking them to describe the hardships they had suffered. Then they made an offer of a thought or a prayer, and they tied the offer of money to the offer of money. What did they discover? Christians valued prayer from strangers, putting its worth at more than $4. The non-religious participants, however, said that they would pay more than $3.50 to avoid a Christian stranger's prayer. This finding raises an interesting point, said a Denver psychologist. Some people maybe just don't want your thoughts and prayers. Perhaps they're atheists or agnostics who don't believe in the power of prayer. Or maybe they feel that the offer of a prayer is a platitude, one that takes the place of meaningful action. Even within the Christian community, many faithful people desire a strong link between words and actions. In his New Testament letter, James writes, "If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, 'Go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill,' and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? Faith without works, according to James, is dead." In a similar manner, many Christians today will argue that prayer without action is dead. Consider the mothers being honored today on Mother's Day. Are they going to be happy with thoughts and prayers? Maybe not. They want a visit or a call and maybe a card and a gift. And many men will feel the same for Father's Day. Loving action is what is needed, with good reason. But not every human need can be met with gifts of clothing, food, or other contributions. At times, nothing really can be offered except thoughts and prayers. Think of a relative dying of terminal illness, or a friend going through a divorce, or a family member who is feeling deeply discouraged. Yeah, you can visit them, listen to them, love them, and support them, but there's not much we can do to remove, mitigate, or solve their problems. Thoughts and prayers are what we have to offer. All of which raises the question, what's the real value of prayer? Most of us would argue that it's worth more than $4, but what specifically are our prayer values? What's the true value of prayer? For starters, prayer changes us. More than changing the outcome of the situation in front of us, whether it's a natural disaster or a terminal illness, prayer changes our relationship with God. Psalm 31 is a prayer for deliverance, and it includes the appeal to God, "Incline your ear to me, rescue me speedily, be a rock of refuge to me, a strong fortress to save me." This prayer is all about the deepening of a relationship. It asks for God to hear us and rescue us, and it requests that God be a rock of refuge, a place of safety and stability, a mighty fortress, a location of salvation. What it does not request is a change to the situation being faced. A few years ago, a group called American Atheists put up a billboard outside the Super Bowl which said, "A Hail Mary only works in football." Then the group issued a press release that said, "It's time to stop believing that prayer works." The atheists had a point. Fans should not pray for their team to win. Players should not ask God to help them catch a pass or get the ball into the end zone. Prayer does not change the outcome of a football game. But the American atheists were wrong to say that prayer does not work. Prayer changes the people who pray, making them more peaceful, accepting, and connected to Almighty God. "You are indeed my rock and my fortress," For your name's sake, lead me and guide me, says Psalm 31 in its appeal to God. Prayer doesn't change the path of hurricanes or the outcome of sporting events, but it does change us. It draws us into a deeper relationship with the God who saves us, even as it asks God's leadership and guidance. One of the most well-known modern prayers is a serenity prayer, said first by Protestant theologian Reinhold Niebuhr during World War II. It's now central to the recovery from addiction being achieved in thousands of 12-step groups. God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and wisdom to know the difference. Notice that God is not being asked in this prayer to miraculously eliminate a desire for alcohol or narcotics. Instead, God is being asked to give serenity, courage, and wisdom to people so they can become well. As is said in a book called How Al-Anon Works, we turn to the God of our understanding for the attributes necessary to live life more fully. In other words, praying people turn to God and ask for help to live better lives. By praying to God in this way, millions of people have become sober through 12-step groups across our country and around the world. In each of these groups, the Serenity Prayer is said to change the hearts and minds of people, not the heart and mind of God. Another value of prayer is that it gives us skills to face the challenges of life. With the midwinter Super Bowl behind us, our thoughts might be turning to other games. And sadly, prayer does not mean that pitchers will suddenly be able to throw 100 mile per hour fastballs, or that batters are able to knock curveballs out of the park, or that we can hit that golf ball all the way down to the green. Prayer never changes the speed of a ball, the swing of a bat, or the trajectory of a golf ball. But people, players, who pray for serenity, courage, and wisdom will find their prayers answered, and they will be given the attributes they need to be the best players they can possibly be. In baseball, if you're batting 300, you're a star, says Stephen Rossetti, chaplain to the world champion Washington Nationals. And that means the other two times you're striking out. The point is, hang in there, stay in the fight. And the same is true for each of us. Whether you're facing a tough situation in a ball game, at school, at home, or in the office, mental and emotional health is always going to be an asset. Hang in there. Pray for serenity, courage, and wisdom. People often talk about prayer not being allowed in school, and I remember as a teenager in school, I never started my tests immediately. I always took a minute to pray. Now, did I pray, God, please help me know the answers? No, because I either knew them or I didn't at that point. But I did pray for God to give me strength and clarity as I took the test. Big difference. God isn't going to suddenly give me the answers, but God can sure help me to ground myself, give me serenity as I look at the questions to answer. Eileen Flanagan has written a book on the Serenity Prayer called The Wisdom to Know the Difference. In it, she quotes a study which found that wise people are able to step outside themselves and assess a troubling situation with calm reflection. They recast a crisis as a problem to be addressed, a puzzle to be solved. They take action in situations they can control and accept the inability to do so when matters are outside their control. These are the kinds of challenges that professional athletes, that students, we all face. We face them when we encounter health challenges, relationship troubles, and crises of various kinds. My times are in your hand, says the writer of Psalm 31. Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me in your steadfast love. We are going to experience the greatest serenity when we know that everything we face is in God's hands. On top of this, we can handle problems most effectively when we believe that God is with us, working to save us in every time and place and situation. Another value of prayer is that it aligns us with the will of God for healing and wholeness in human life. God wants us all to have serenity, courage, and wisdom, regardless of the particular challenges we face. And when life is overwhelming, we can pray for God to rescue us and save us. God wants to save us from the worst that life can throw at us, even death itself. Serenity comes from the knowledge that in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. Neither death, nor life, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The value of prayer goes far beyond that $4 that a Christian in North Carolina will pay to have a stranger offer a prayer. Prayer changes us and draws us closer to God. Prayer gives us skills to face the challenges of life, and prayer aligns us with the will of God for healing and wholeness. So let's offer each other our thoughts and our prayers. They are worth far more than a scholarly study can possibly reveal. Amen. Loving God, you who are both mother and father to us, in this time of prayer, we thank you for your love. We thank you for Jesus, who taught us of your all-encompassing parent's love, the love that waits with anxiety for us to return home, the love that also runs down the road to gather us in your arms, the love that searches until we are found, that loved us so much you sent us Jesus. We thank you that we are your children, called by name, called even before we were formed in our mother's womb, called into your worldwide family, where there is such diversity, such individuality, such creativity, such beauty. We ask that rejoicing in the diversity of humankind, we might always love as Jesus loved us, that we might always appreciate others of different faith and cultures, asking pardon for the times when we have failed you in love. Remembering the worldwide family we are so much a part of, we pray for places around the world. We give you thanks for our own families, remembering especially our own mothers, or those who stood in her place, who took care of us, who met our needs, not only nurturing our bodies, but also in love and security. For the love of those who are still with us, and for the love that is in your nearer presence, we give you thanks. And knowing the imperfect nature of humankind, where there may be a need of forgiveness, that you would forgive and help us to forgive. For mothers at the start of the adventure of motherhood, that you will give them all they need. For mothers who are stretched in patience and love, who find things hard, with too much to do and not enough time to do it. With babies who don't sleep, children with special gifts, running out of energy and patience. For mothers whose children do not have clean water, or enough food to eat, or proper medication. For mothers experiencing miscarriages or babies stillborn, or those unable to have children, that their motherly natures would be used in nurturing others. Loving God, in you we find life, health, and strength. Through your gifts we have everything we need, and so we bring to you ourselves. We ask, Lord, that you use our gifts, our talents, our time, and our good intentions for the growth of your kingdom on earth. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who taught us all to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the glory and the power forever. Amen.